to the Eating at a Meeting podcast. I'm your host, Tracy Stuckrath, dietary needs expert, certified meetings manager, certified food protection manager. I have searched the globe to find people and businesses who are creating safe, sustainable, and inclusive food and beverage experiences for their employees, guests, and communities. In each episode, you will find authentic conversations about how food and beverage impacts inclusion, sustainability, culture, community, health, and wellness. I know that sounds like a lot, but we're going to cover it all. Are you ready to feed engagement, nourish inclusion, and bolster your bottom line? If so, let's go. Hi, everybody. And in this show, we talk about all things food and beverage, talking with farmers and doctors and eaters. And today's guest is an HR expert who I've known for a couple of years now, and we've had conversations about food and beverage in the workplace multiple times. So because we both share food allergy challenges, and we both talk about eating at work or eating at a meeting. So we're going to bring it to you live today. So my guest, surprise, surprise, is Noor Burns, an expert in leadership and workplace culture and a former meeting planner. Noor has been an advocate for inclusion-based employee meal planning for decades. She's a speaker and a consultant, although you may know her as the undercover employee, which we'll talk about that a little bit as well. She joins us today from her hometown in Denver, Colorado. Hi, Noor.
Hello, Tracy. Just to make it official, I also qualify under the eater category for...
Yes, you do. And that's an important thing. I was talking to somebody last week, and this is before I ask you any questions. It's like a lot of these companies and a lot of the education around all of this comes from people who have challenges in these areas, and they create businesses and that help other people like them. And that's how I got started as well. So and how you and I got on this conversation in that beautiful little diner that we had breakfast at, that awesome.
Oh, the Morning Collective.
Yeah. Morning Collective
in Denver. I'm so sad it is no longer there.
Really?
No. Oh. That's a, they, it's the same restaurant group, I think, is starting another shop. But yeah, but one of the things I loved about the Morning Collective was the fact that they had a really easy to accommodate menu. So it was a great place for me to have business meetings because it didn't matter what your food issues were. If you were simply trying to avoid something for dietary purposes for your own like diet, like losing weight of it, or because of a medical issue or because of a religious issue or because of any other reason, right? Whatever the reason is, you could easily order from the menu without coming off as, without anybody being condescending or patronizing or like, oh, kind of a thing. So I love that about that place.
Oh yeah. And it was to boot, the food was delicious.
Oh, so good.
So good. Oh. All right. Well, I hope they come up with something just as good with their new concept. So one of the questions that I ask everybody before they come onto the show, because we talk about safe, sustainable, and inclusive, what does a safe, sustainable, and inclusive food and beverage experience mean to you or look like to you?
Right. Like I could play with just that question for a solid 45 minutes, by the way, because there is some variation based on the situation. But for me, it means that there's no food, there's no shaming around it, right? Like we shouldn't feel bad about what we want to eat or can eat or need to eat in order to sustain our health. And so there's no shame around it, that there are a variety of options and choices without us having to make special request, without having to be the person that comes over and says, oh, do you happen to have version of that that is gluten-free, that is, you know, that is, you know, without nuts, that is what have you. To make it easy, people should be able to sustain life fairly easy. So for me, it means that we can easily sustain our life and make sure that we are in a learning space, because usually when I'm dealing with food, it's in meetings and events or corporate settings where we need to be learning and productive, where we can do that without it being a hassle for us as the person who needs to nourish our bodies.
I love that. And it reminds me of a conversation. I don't know where we were, but you know, if somebody's asking you that question in advance, which hopefully anybody who's planning any kind of meeting is doing, And you go there and then you see a sign that says gluten-free upon request.
Yeah. Well,
if I told you in advance, why do I need to then request it again?
Yeah, I think we were at a shared conference, if I recall, yeah, when this first came up, and I had submitted gluten-free. And then when I went to get something, there was this sign and I just thought, I've already made the request. Why do I have to make the request twice? Right. But it's making it easy, right? Like having, right, knowing in advance how you can accommodate. Now it's one thing if we've run out of the gluten-free option or the, right, vegan option or the no nuts option, and now I need to go seek it out. But, right, but yeah, I thought that was like, maybe I'm the only one who checked that box. There's only one dessert sitting somewhere for me.
Yeah, no, you were not, because I was. Okay. So the next question is, and really kind of why, you know, you and I have talked about this before, but I saw a post on one of the social media outlets that when is it appropriate, as an coming from your HR perspective, when is it appropriate for, you know, an employer to ask about in one of their employees' dietary needs? And I'm going to tell you one little story about that before you answer that. Is I met a planner years ago who did a job fair kind of event. And through the whole week, she had everybody who had requested special meals or got there, requested them when they sat down and asked for them. But on that last night, where then they were eating with their most potential employer, no requests were made. And she's like, what do I do? And my thought is that they were scared to admit, to bring their whole selves to the job opportunity by saying, hey, I need a vegan plate or I need this, because it might actually kick them out of that job opportunity. So can you touch on all of those facets for me?
Right. So I think that that's fascinating, that throughout the week of an event that had to do with job fair, people were like, yes, I need no peanuts or no almonds or no, you know, tree nuts. It comes to mind easily because that happens to be one of my allergies, mm-hmm, or no dairy or what have you. And then when you're sitting across from somebody who's going to make a decision about your future, you're like, nope, I'm just going to go with whatever they put in front of me, right? Mm-hmm. I think of it pretty much like most people would go on a first date, right? So often on a first date, you don't want, if you have all of these food things, people don't always bring them their whole selves forward, as you say. Mm-hmm. And so they pick around and maybe they just don't eat as much and they eliminate some things from the plate that they can work around, but they don't want to be the high maintenance. So this phrase makes me crazy, mm-hmm, quote unquote, the high maintenance diner. And I absolutely see why a job candidate would not want to say that in front of their hiring manager. They don't want to be seen as somebody who's going to have that extra ask. And if it's not easily available, they might simply skip it, right? So I would love to have interviewed those people afterwards to say, what was going through your mind? Why did you make that decision? Yeah. Mm-hmm. And the reality is, in the hiring process, which I do so much work around helping organizations design hiring processes that eliminate or at least limit our natural bias, because we've got very conscious and unconscious bias. And I think this is one that's going to factor in for most people's unconscious bias, right? Like, right, oh, it's down to these two candidates. Oh, remember when we were eating and that person, and even if they don't consciously think about it, somewhere in the back of their mind, they're just going to say, I don't know, there was something. I don't know what it was. They just seemed to. So I get that, but that's part of a larger societal food shaming and allergen shaming culture, yes, right? And bullying, mm-hmm, around our food. And it just, it's a bigger societal kind of a thing. Right. Now, in terms of when should you ask someone about this? I don't want to ask about it. As a hiring manager, I'm not going to ask anybody about food allergies during the hiring process itself. Somebody's going to be an employee before we get to that conversation. Now, that means if as part of your hiring process, you, assuming we're not in the middle of a pandemic, right, you take someone to lunch or you take them to dinner and you have those types of interview segments built into your hiring process, I want you to make sure that you're going to a restaurant that it is easy for someone to make an order, like that morning collective that we talked about. Here in Denver, another great example, I have no affiliation to them, by the way, is Linger. Linger has a really great and easy to follow menu, makes it easy for people to order. And I all of a sudden, like, restaurants are coming to mind in Denver, but making it easy for someone to have that ordering experience without the shame, making sure that you're selecting a restaurant there. But I don't want to ask during the hiring process unless there's a meal being served, which would be really unusual.
Right.
If you have a large banquet situation that somebody's going to as a candidate, if you would call me and talk to me about that process, I'd love to hear about it. Right? Because that would be really unusual. Yeah. But it changes when somebody's in-house in your organization. If your organization is one that provides food on a regular basis, I don't want people to be building it into their hiring and their onboarding rather practices if it really has no relevance, right? Okay. We don't provide snacks. We don't provide food. We have two meals a year that we do anything around. Mm-hmm. Now, a lot of the technology firms I work with, they have food on site as part of their perks all the time.
Right.
And we're not in a pandemic. And so there, you're going to want to make sure that there's something available to everyone. Otherwise, that perk is actually an insult, right? If we've got this wall of snacks, I don't know how many of these offices you've been in, but it's amazing when you go into technology startup firms and there's this whole wall of snacks. And if none of them accommodate what I need, then mm-hmm. it's actually insulting and it's actually going to backfire on you and it's not going to be a benefit. So.
Yeah. And that's so true because that's a benefit of employment. And actually that would then fall under the ADA issue as well, providing that option.
Yeah.
Going back to that job fair scenario, when I was talking to that planner, I said, my suggestion, she's like, what do I do? And so my suggestion to her, and let me know, I want your opinion on this too, is let's talk to those employers and get them to start describing their workplace environment so that it says we're inclusive of everyone. And when we plan events or our snack wall, you know, we've got options for, you know, kosher and gluten-free, and we make sure of that. So that person can make that decision comfortably, you know, about that employment. What do you think about that?
I like it being part of our inclusivity statement as a whole, right? Like, and not only our statement, but our culture, and that we make sure that we're not doing those teasing behaviors and bullying behaviors when somebody requests something without dairy or that's kosher or what have you. But I also like making it really easy in any meetings and events space so that people can subtly request what they need. So I've worked with organizations where we've had different color placemats and people just select the placemat that is appropriate to what their dietary restriction is, which works with the larger groupings. It doesn't work with the fine tuning, right? It won't work with, I'm allergic to olives. Like, we're not going to have a placemat for olives, right? So we don't have that larger kind of a thing. The other is erring on the side of an inclusive meal overall. So there are so many things that can be done. If you've got a lot of people who are coming who are vegetarian, there's some amazing vegetarian dishes
that
any meat lover is going to still love. Now, I'm the daughter of a beef farmer, right? Like, I love me a good steak. So even I will, there's meals that you can just eliminate that. So if you know who's coming and you know that you have 10% of the population is vegan, then, or at least are vegetarian, we can at least make that the baseline accommodation without taking anything really away from anyone else.
Right.
And as a meeting and event planner, having an event that doesn't involve steak and chicken is actually cheaper.
Right. That's very true. Yeah.
Just saying. Yeah. Now, you're not going to do that if you're working with the Cattlemen's Association. That's a whole different element if the association or the event that you're working with, the organization you're working with is food based. That's going to be a little bit different.
Yeah, it'll be challenging. Actually, that reminds me of a I posted something years ago on LinkedIn promoting a gluten-free course I was doing, and somebody who worked for the Wheat Association went off on me. And I'm like, okay, I'm not saying that wheat's bad. I'm just saying there's people who can't eat wheat, right? Yeah. And I'm sure there's actually some people who might actually be attending your association who are gluten-free, yeah, right? And as a meeting planner, you have that responsibility, no matter, you know, because there may be people who go to the Cattlemen's Association that are don't eat meat, right? Because maybe they got an allergy to it. They have the alpha-gal or, you know, whatever. So they're, it's just opening up your mind to saying, hey, this is not about me and my association. This is about their well-being.
Well, and I think it is, I think it's more rare that you'll have somebody at the Cattlemen's Association who doesn't eat meat than you will at the Wheat Growers Association. Yeah. As a gluten intolerance, just it's a more common medical ailment, yes, knowledge. But I do think those are really tough, right? Like when you start talking about your food-based association and enabling and making sure that we are enabling inclusion, it's really tough when our whole business is based on this particular food group, food product, food, right, you know, yep, element. But for most of our events, we don't have that. For most of our events, we've got a mix and a broad range, and having subtle ways that people can select a placemat that's yellow that tells you that I'm going to get the chicken, that's, you know, that's green that's going to tell you that I'm getting that hungry, idea. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Eliminates that conversation in, right, in the height of that hiring process.
Yep.
Again, most of us, while we're hiring, we don't have that. We might offer coffee or tea, a soda, water, kinds of things more likely than we have a large meal situation.
Right. That's true. Yeah. And you know, water is a simple solution. There is one woman who is allergic to water that I was on the cover of Allergic Living magazine. Yeah. Another story for another time, but there's like 50 people in the world with that.
I have to go look that up.
I know. She can drink it through a straw, but she couldn't, like, she could only take a shower like once or twice a week for like 5 minutes because it's crazy, yeah, but it is a specific condition. Yeah. So
that's an outlier. I would not make your plans based on that outlier, right?
Right. Exactly. So, one of the other things that I've seen come up quite a bit over the years, is HIPAA. And actually I saw a post last week from a planner, and it happened to do with somebody requesting a sign language interpreter for them. But I see this also coming, you know, with dietary restrictions. And actually somebody mentioned it at an event I spoke at last year, the religious-based dietary needs, you know, the attorneys are like, oh, you can't make sure who you're sending that information to keeps it secure and safe, because you never know if those people could get targeted for eating a kosher diet or eating a halal diet. But, you know, where does HIPAA, and those aren't medical, yeah, but it's still personal information, but where does HIPAA lie in that whole conversation with HR? Because HR put a red flag on that for that meeting planner.
Oh, the idea of asking people about allergens in advance of an event.
How can you communicate that out to other people who need to know?
Yeah. So one of the things behind HIPAA is that it's your information to share, not my information to share, right? So if they choose to share the information with me, I can make my plans accordingly, but I can't then share that information with someone else. So if I'm having a meeting with 400 people and I ask about allergens and I ask about dietary requirements as part of the registration form, right? Uh-huh. I have to make sure that I'm protecting the information if it's a medical condition, from a HIPAA standpoint, to make sure that I'm not then putting that same spreadsheet that says, yes, I'm allergic to whatever, out to the whole world, right? Out to, you know, 70 people part of the conference team. The AV team doesn't care that somebody's allergic to tree nuts, but we shouldn't be sending them that information, right? So just being able to strip it down. Now, I can work with the catering team knowing what that list is. when people come into the event, they can choose like the cards that you have available mm-hmm. that say I'm gluten-free or I'm meat-free or I'm whatever, right? You have them right there. Perfect. Yeah. Once I choose that card, and you can say you can choose this card, I choose the card. I am now sharing my information. The organizer's not sharing the information. I'm sharing the information. So there's no risk kind of within that because I'm the one who chose to share it. Where the HIPAA could come into play, again, I think the risk is not significant because we're all like, as a consultant, I'll say, this is what the rules are. This is what my guidelines would say. Uh-huh. And then you decide, you weigh the risk. How big of a risk is it? And are you willing to take that risk? Right. So just like in hiring, I say, please stop asking that question. It violates all kinds of things. And they're like, nope, I'm still going to ask the question. I'm like, that's your decision, that you're weighing the risk. I've told you what my recommendation would be. So it's the name tags. I would not have it on the name tag where it's like, I'm Nora. Tree nut allergy, right? you're like, yes, I'm also, you know, O positive blood type, right? Like people don't need to know. The whole world doesn't need to know. And it's a distraction. So I would eliminate it from that kind of mechanism, but I would allow attendees to select the placemat, the little card, something that I then choose to let identify. If I don't want to publicly identify, then I need to have the conversation with the wait staff to say, I'm the one who asked for the vegetarian meal.
Okay. So kind of on that note, you could on that registration site, if they say, hey, I am gluten-free, whatever, you can say, put a box there. Are you okay with us communicating this information to the caterer? Or would you like to talk to the caterer directly?
Yeah.
That would actually be
great.
Yeah.
And also, as I think of it, for me, it's all about the shifting the perspective. Like if I'm the attendee and I see that and you've given me that option, that's fantastic.
Yeah.
The other thing that I really like, and I don't see it very often, but I am a huge fan, especially for smaller meetings, is where I have a special... I and anybody who has special meal requirements at any given point has a place to store our own food, right? So that I'm not walking around with a cooler all day. Mm-hmm. Now, I notice this more, my actual medical condition, my allergens don't rely on this, right? Because tree nuts, dairy, I don't need to carry my food with me. But when I stripped out a whole lot of different foods to try to test for allergens. So for 30 days, I had eliminated a bunch of things. Uh-huh. During those 30 days, I had some pretty tight requirements. So I would just bring my own food with me. And during that time, to see a meeting that had little refrigerators where I could put my food in there and I wasn't carrying it around all day, having to explain to people why I was carrying such a big bag. Like, what did you all bring with you? And I'm like,
your shoulder goes like this with carrying food. It does.
Yeah. Yeah. But it's a really, when you put it over into the, how does the attendee feel? Mm-hmm. It's just such a cool experience. And the same thing is making sure that we've got in our workplaces, places where people can store food safely. You know, we often have the shared, you know, lunchroom kind of a thing. And there's all kinds of weird statistics and data about the shared refrigerator. So wherever we can have a couple of those around would be great. They say nobody ever owns up to saying that they've actually like taken somebody else's lunch, but somewhere in the neighborhood of 60% of people will say that somebody at some point has taken their lunch or some food that they've brought into the office. And if you have very strict dietary requirements and now somebody has helped themselves to your lunch, that's problematic. So food safety goes beyond like making sure we've got the right temperature. It also goes beyond the fact that I have access to the food that I need, right? So thinking about that as an employer is, again, going to that next level to really make sure that people feel safe, secure, and they have the ability to nourish themselves.
I love that that conversation because it's just making sure that they have that space. And then, you know, in the sorority, it made me think of the sorority house, and it was no name, fair game. And in the refrigerator, because at that time, our sorority house didn't have a culinary team. We made our own food, but that like takes me to the, you know, workplace cafeteria, right? Mm-hmm. And creating that inclusive experience with that cafeteria. There's an HR manager who I met or chatted with, and she was vegetarian, but the vegetable soup was made with chicken broth. And so
they used my mom's recipe.
Right. So it's like figuring out those kind of things. And actually there's a podcast episode with Amelia Eckes that I did a couple months ago, and she works in workplace dining. And what she's done with those experiences is really, really cool. I'll share that with you, yeah. That podcast episode, but it's creating those experiences. And how does that impact culture? And, you know, when you're thinking about the cultural environment and somebody's got a dietary need, does that impact their productivity levels? Does that impact their, mm-hmm. how they feel, like the well-being or the belonging in that association or organization? Yeah,
without question. It falls under our inclusivity and making sure that everybody feels that their brilliance is valued and that their whole self can come to work. And it's, the thing is, if there's food bullying, if there's allergen bullying, if there's that kind of teasing that's taking place about what I eat, mm-hmm. It's belittling and it's making me feel smaller. And when I'm feeling smaller and insignificant, it is hard for me to bring you my most brilliant ideas. And so we want to eliminate the things that are going to be barriers to someone bringing their brilliance to the forefront. And right. So just like with any harassment that happens in any category within the workplace, it makes people feel smaller. So making, just eliminating some of those barriers. So now I just thought of a couple of things that I definitely want to mention around this. So yeah. One is this whole came to my light so many years ago, like decades ago, when I was relatively new and I was on the HR team for a manufacturing company, and we had just gone above and beyond. We'd met a contract. It was like one of those all hands on deck. The manager was so excited and was rewarding the team and came up to me and said, "Hey, I'd love for you to join us. Like, I have pizza coming in on Friday for the whole team to reward them and say thank you." And I was like, "Thank you for including me." Because again, I had helped recruit the whole team that had been part of that. And I was like, "Thanks for mm-hmm. thinking of me. I'd like to explore what you're all going to order." And kind of looked at me like, "What?" And I said, because I know that there are a couple people on your team that, on this team that was part of this, that cannot eat the combination of meat and cheese. And so what are we going to make sure that we have for them? Right. And it's Friday during a religious time of year. And so we've got some religious things going on there. And he kind of looked at me like in complete and utter amazement, had not crossed his mind at all. Like, he wasn't offended by the idea. It was outside of his parameter. And that's often where these things happen. We accidentally stumble into things where we have accidentally offended someone and mm-hmm. put a barrier between us and them, simply because it's not in our purview and it's right. not something that we've dealt with in our life. And so it was great. So I was so glad he mentioned it to me when he did, because it was like a Tuesday or Wednesday, right? So we still had time mm-hmm. to adjust the schedule and have some salad brought in and have some other options brought in so that it wasn't strictly pizza. And right. the thing is, pizza has been the go-to cheap option for managers yep. to reward their teams for decades. Mm-hmm. And this story, I'm trying to remember what year that would have been. Like, it seriously was decades. It was probably 1990 when that happened.
Wow.
And yeah, I am that old.
You are. Because if you are, then I am. No, we're not that
old. So yeah, because so that was 1990. Except just a month ago, I heard a story about an organization that sent pizza to mm-hmm. their team.
Yep.
And now I am a pizza lover. Like, off the top of my head now, I'm going to have to go to Chaos Pizza here in Denver for lunch, because I've put it out there and they've got this amazing margarita with prosciutto situation that I love. Right. So I love it, but nothing on that pizza impacts my dietary restrictions as they stand today.
Right.
But it's for so many people, it's just the combination of ingredients. Yeah. And so making sure that you don't accidentally offend someone or make them feel not included because you've just sent something they can't eat when your intent was, and the intent that I just heard about in the last month was inclusivity and wanting to make sure everybody had a shared experience and that we were, you know, part of this larger organization, and how kind and thoughtful that I found a way to have food come to you while we are all living apart. And is the intent was there. We just had a slight misstep on the execution.
Right.
So what can end up happening is a delivery driver shows up at my house. Imagine the thing that you like the least in the world. So even if you're not allergic to anything, imagine the thing that you like the least in the world that other people love.
Right.
So yeah. Other people love it. I just did this post on my Facebook page about like, what holiday food does everybody else in your family love? And you're like, why do we make this? Right.
Stuffing.
Right. Yeah. So for me, it's seafoam salad. My family has an affinity for seafoam salad. The recipe actually says quadruple for Thanksgiving on it. Like quadruple this recipe. So the seafoam salad, I despise it. So imagine for me, somebody shows up at my door and I'm like, ooh, somebody's at my door and they've got a package. They've got a present. It's so exciting. I love me a present. And then I open up the present and it's a quadruple recipe of the seafoam salad. Right. Like, so now not only do I not have something that I like, which is what they were trying to do, I have to try to figure out how to get rid of this.
And
who do I give this to? Because I'm not going to throw food that would be good for other people into my dumpster. So now you've given me work. You've given me a job to do. So I think of it that way. So, so all of this to say, sometimes the low hanging fruit is not the way to go. Although sending fruit is almost always good because most people aren't allergic to fruit. But if you're doing something, especially in times now, we're trying to find a way to make sure that our employees are feeling valued and part of our team. Mm-hmm. I love the idea of sending packages to people's homes from your organization, from your manager, of saying, hey, let me provide you with a meal or with access to a meal. But there's ways you can do that depending upon your area, to do that through gift certificates to your local restaurants that have a variety of different options, right? That also support your local economy. Please know, as I say this, I want to make sure that if I say the idea of like using Uber Eats, that if I do that in a town that doesn't have Uber Eats as an option, I've just done the seafoam salad example, right?
Yep. I've experienced that myself with a different company. Yep.
Yeah. So you know, years ago, I'd said to, I used to give Starbucks gift cards as thank yous to managers who were helping me out within organizations, which works really well unless you hit an organization that, an area that doesn't have a Starbucks. So I remember going to a small town in Kansas that I was working with, and they didn't have a Starbucks at that time. Now they do, but they didn't at that time. And so instead I sent a gift certificate to like the most popular local diner situation, you know, that had a variety of
different cars.
But finding it so that it's important to them. Because well, the saying goes that it's the thought that counts. That's not always entirely true when we're talking about employees. Because it means you didn't an employee gifting an employee food, because it means you didn't think of me.
Mm-hmm.
You thought of how can I do this for a large population of people without giving consideration to the individual.
Right.
And to really design a workplace culture where everybody feels valued, you need to put that extra step of thought into how do I make sure that everybody feels this love?
Right. That's so true. And I love the comment about, you know, the local economy. So if you've got, like, I worked for an organization for the last 3 years, helping them do an event in 19 different locations. And, you know, let them figure out what that local favorite place is to utilize versus sending, you know, Starbucks gift cards or that generic gift card to everybody, because that's helping the local economy, especially right now with what we're experiencing.
Yeah.
And it adds that that local flair to it. I had a story in there, but it's escaped my brain already. it'll come back. And we're at 34 minutes already, but somebody posted on here, should events allow a place to heat food if you bring your own? And that's a touchy subject. That's going to have to really go with the venue that you're using, and what their policies and procedures are, because, you know, a lot of times no outside food and beverage is allowed to be brought in. I do know of at least one property. I know of one property, I should say, that is using outside caterers because they've let go of all of their catering teams. Mm. So they've got outside caterings coming in. They do have one preferred company, but they are allowing that to come in. So I think it's a little bit hard and to figure that out. But if you can make arrangements with just Nora saying, hey, Nora's bringing this food. Chef, can you do this for her? Or can you, this is the type of food she's going to bring. Can you recreate this? I think that's the better solution, because food safety wise, I don't know if we can go put a whole bunch of microwaves in, you know, a break room in a meeting space. So I definitely think that comes down to the venue and the catering company that you're working with.
Yeah. So. The one that I went to that had a refrigerator situation where I could stash my own food was a small event that was doing like ordering from, you know, it wasn't Panera, but something like that. Right. We'll have food delivered. And then they simply couldn't or didn't accommodate other unique situations. But it wasn't like an event being held at the Marriott or the Four Seasons or at something like that where they have food on site. So I think there is definitely the situational element. Now, if I have, it will depend on that. And there are food regulations. And I'm a former catering manager. So I can appreciate being like, oh, I could probably create that. And have another option for you as well. But there's definitely, and this is like so many things, like when I do HR consulting, it flashes me back to Ronald Reagan's years, because Ronald Reagan had this quote where he said, I just want to meet a one-armed economist, because they always say, well, on the one hand and on the other hand. And so I always flash to that, because I think as an HR consultant, as a leadership consultant, I often have that. I'm like, well, on the one hand and on the other hand, it's very situational dependent, right? Are we having this meeting where we're having food brought into a big training space that we have on our own site?
Right.
That's going to have a different requirement and different things that we can accommodate than if I'm holding it at a Marriott property or at a Sheraton property, right? Kind of a thing that then they're going to have some different rules. So there will be some situational levels within that.
So I was talking to Donna Mack and that the other day, and that broadcast is going to come up shortly or later. Cause we did it offline, but you know, she's got a guide dog, and that reminds me, we were talking about bringing guide dogs into meeting spaces, into food and beverage spaces and things like that. But there was an article I found somewhere on the internet, where one employee had an allergy to peanuts. And so she had a dog that could actually sniff out peanuts to protect her, to keep that person safe. But one of their coworkers was allergic to dogs. So, how do you, you as a dog lover, that would be horrible for you, but how, you know, that's on one hand and on another hand, you know, how do you balance that out? And with our predicament now, it kind of works out, but if you're going to an office space.
Yeah. It's very interesting. Allergies to animals. I love to hear what you and Donna talked about through this. Allergies to animals are a very interesting thing. There, about 5 years ago, I swear I must have written no less than a dozen policies for organizations, drafted policies on bring your dog to work situations, because all of a sudden there was this huge push of people wanting to bring their dogs to work. And this situation came up of like, what do we do with allergens, right? So one of the biggest things that we did then, and again, I'm not an attorney. I do not play one on TV. Always talk to an attorney before publishing an employment policy, because sometimes there's local regulations, state regulations, and new interpretations of federal law that have happened that I, as a non-lawyer, have not tracked. But the fact that we then made sure that we built it into our hiring process, it was in the ad, right? Like it was all part of who we were. It was in the website. There were pictures of people with their dogs. Anybody who's allergic to dogs who looks at that job ad is going to be like, nope, no way. I can't do that. Right. It's like, I happen to be allergic to cats. If I look at your website and it's got a whole bunch of employees pictured with their cats and it's a cat friendly workplace and you show me a video and I can see that there's a litter box over in the corner, I'm going to be like, oh, you seem like a lovely company, but I am sneezing just watching your video. Right. I'm going to self select out in that situation.
Right.
It becomes an issue when it develops along the way. This years ago, we had big fragrance policies that started coming up because people can develop allergies just like they can grow out of allergies.
Right.
And so if you're working somewhere and you develop an allergy and a sensitivity to fragrance and you happen to cube on the other side of a wall from somebody who's decided that like three sprays of, you know, the strongest perfume on the world is the right place, then we have to navigate that. Relationship and to make sure that we accommodate people. And so, yeah, there's some layering, which is why workplaces are so complex. But I do want to get, there's one thing I want to make sure that we talk about. And that is something that I experienced as the undercover employee. So for those of you who on your podcast, you follow your podcast, you don't know this about me. I worked at five different Fortune 500 companies, not in my capacity as a leadership and HR consultant, but rather on the front lines where the people I worked with and the people I worked for had no idea that I'm actually an expert in leadership and workplace culture. They saw me as the cashier, the warehouse employee, the driver that, you know, I cleaned a lot of bathrooms during this period of time. So for 15 months, I worked on that front line. And one of the things I noticed as it relates to food in the workplace is in the break room, vending machines.
So
vending machines, and there was this big push a couple of years ago where people were putting the little leaf emblem on like healthier snacks, right? And so you'd look at the vending machine and it'd say like this whole row is got the little green leaf on it, but there's nothing in that row. Like, we haven't restocked that row. It's not that everybody has gobbled up the healthy snacks.
Right.
It's the fact that the vending machine company stopped stocking it because it wasn't turning over enough. But it takes some time. It takes some traction. And it might take a financial investment from the company to make sure that those are there and paid for.
Right.
So that it's not the burden of that finance isn't on the vending machine company. So you'd go in and it'd all be things that were high in fat, high in sugar, high in lots of different things that I probably shouldn't be eating at 2 o'clock in the morning when I quick make a run to the vending machine.
What are you doing at work at 2 o'clock in the morning?
Stocking shelves.
Okay. So, okay. Gotcha.
Yeah. Okay. So that's when we stock shelves. So if I'm at work late at night, and I'm working on the front line, people who don't always have easy access to really healthy foods. So what do we have available in our break rooms? And for some, they had snacks available. They had, you know, different kinds of granola bars and things that would be out and stocked in baskets. But again, those of us with tree nut allergies, you got to stay away from most of those. And it's just so, it's a fairly simple thing to just put some fresh fruit in that same break room. It's going to rot, so you're going to have to get rid of it. It doesn't have a shelf life of 3 years like a lot of the other products do. One extra step. But the thing is, quite frankly, if you've got a healthy frontline team, you're in a much better shape, right? Yeah. So I wanted to not leave without talking about that vending machine and the snacks that we have out for our employees as a whole. And I am incredibly grateful. One silver lining of the pandemic that we're in is that maybe, just maybe, we can be done having birthday cakes at work where people blow out candles and blow on a cake.
Oh, yeah. Some people come up with those sniffer things that you can put them out that way, but yeah. Yeah. Do it that way.
Then again, there was not enough Purell in the world for me before this all started. So yeah.
All right. So we could talk. I've got stories that are just popping into my head left and right. So we could continue talking, but I'm going to let it go. And maybe we come back with some other stories on another episode. So I want to end it with understanding or you sharing, what is your favorite food and drink? food and beverage?
Oh my gosh. You know, you had asked me this earlier and I was like, oh, what is my favorite food and drink? What is my favorite food and drink? Like right now, I kind of feel like, coffee. Is this coffee count as both a food and a beverage? Coffee has been my go-to. I got a little addicted to my Nespresso and to the Stormio pods. I might have a problem with that. And I'm drinking a lot more coffee since I'm at home. My dentist is going to have to do some work after this. And one of my favorite food items, I just flashed to, we've been talking about my grandmother's recipes, and I just flashed to my grandmother's German chocolate cake with fudge frosting.
Oh, wow.
That's just amazing. It's like two desserts in one. My overall favorite food ever is probably sushi and Copper River salmon in particular. Like when it's Copper River salmon season, I've got to get myself to a sushi restaurant and fast. Okay.
I don't think I've ever paid attention to the fish that's actually being put into the sushi before. So that's a good thing. Yeah.
Now it's a local restaurant, the Sushi Den here in Denver introduced me to it. And they said, you know, it's a special, it only runs Copper River salmon apparently only runs for four or five, some salmon expert's going to correct me on this, and 4 or 5 weeks. It's a short season that they bring it in. And so when it's there, I'm like at the sushi, I like once a week, anybody's like, you want to go? I'm like, yeah, how do you feel about sushi? I don't need a lot of it. It's expensive. I don't need a lot of it, but it's really delicious.
Okay, good. All right. And then one final thing, how can people find out about you, find you elsewhere?
Right. You can call, you can check my website, theleadershipexperts.com. We're actually working on a revision of it, which I'd hope was going to be done by now. Thankfully, I have been too busy to do the good and bad news of that. Theleadershipexperts.com. You can find me on Instagram most readily. I haven't been on Twitter a lot lately. And also The Leadership Experts has a Facebook page. And so you can call, you can text, you can visit the website. Questions on, especially as it relates to how do you build your workplace culture from the very beginning? And I think that's where a lot of this food comes into place, because if you have during the hiring process a bad experience, people are going to self-select out. You're going to lose some brilliance. So,
well, that so much so. And that even building that from the get-go, and then making sure that everybody knows it. And the beginning of the month was Corporate Compliance and Ethics Week. And so making sure that people are educated about it throughout their entire employment, not shoving it in their face, but subtly making, hey, this is the information that we want to provide to create this safe and inclusive experience for everybody. You know, let's learn, right? Learn together.
Yeah. And it is important that every organization do that from the very beginning, because you don't know what experience they had at their last organization. So we often assume, people know not to make inappropriate jokes or bullying statements or whatever. And just because it's how we do it here doesn't mean that that's how they did it there and what they've learned by behavior.
Right. Yeah, very true. Well, thank you, Nora Burns, the leadership expert. I appreciate it. Thank you, everyone, for joining us here on the Eating at a Meeting podcast. You can download, listen, share everything on the podcast on all your favorite podcast platforms. You can also go to the eatingatameetingpodcast.com to listen to all of the episodes. Today, I was here with Nora Burns, the leadership expert, and we will be back. Love to everyone here. Thank you very much for coming, joining us.
Bye.
Bye. Thanks for listening to the Eating at a Meeting podcast, where every meal matters. I'm Tracy Stuckrath, your food and beverage inclusion expert. Call me and let's get started right now on creating safe and inclusive food and beverage experiences for your customers, your employees, and your communities. Share the podcast with your friends and colleagues at our Eating at a Meeting Facebook page and on all podcast platforms. To learn more about me and receive valuable information, go to tracystuckrath.com. And if you'd like more information on how to feed engagement, nourish inclusion, and bolster your bottom line, then visit eatingatameeting.com.